This is the CDC's Emergency Operations Center. Think of it as the nerve center of its response to the Ebola outbreak. Just a few minutes after I walked in, phones and BlackBerries started buzzing everywhere.
While we were here, the activation level just went up to level one, just in the last couple minutes. What does that mean?
What that means is just more people and more resources dedicated to the response.
In that room, you could feel a quiet determination and a sense of urgency.
Let me give you a little bit of an idea of how this all works. What you're looking at is what the CDC looks at, a map of the world, trying to figure out what infectious diseases are happening and where they're happening. As you might imagine, a lot of focus on Ebola right now. They're tracking that as well, real time. They've been doing it since March. Take a look in here. This really jumped out at me. Mid-May, they thought things were basically under control. But then look what happens at the beginning of June. Everything takes off. This is on its way to becoming the worst Ebola outbreak in history.
So this is our Emergency Operations Center, or EOC as we call it.
And Dr. Stephen Monroe is helping lead the CDC's Ebola response. Not an easy task at all.
Was there mistakes made? I mean, is there a reason why this outbreak is worse than any other outbreak in history?
The initial event, the lightning strike, if you will, was right in this corner between three countries in a very remote part of each of those countries. And so it quickly spread across the borders.
Many more resources are needed, and some of it is on the way. The CDC is sending 50 more people to the region in the next month. Dr. Meredith Dixon just returned from two tours in the remote part of Guinea, where she was trying to help control the outbreak.
One day we were removed from that area because there were rumors that a group of young men would be coming to destroy the treatment center because they wanted to destroy Ebola.
She says that situation never escalated, but it shows the kind of hurdles and confusion the health workers face there. Here in the United States, a different sort of confusion, different questions. For example, if Ebola is not airborne, then why were there such extraordinary precautions taken for Dr. Kent Brantley and Miss Whiteball? Turns out it was more an abundance of caution rather than a necessity.
We're pretty confident that any large hospital could handle an Ebola case if one were to show up at their doorstep, using traditional isolation rooms with a negative pressure room and with traditional droplet and respiratory precautions.
And while I suited up in multiple layers when I was in Guinea just earlier this year, the CDC says a mask, goggles, face shield, a protective gown, and gloves can provide all the protection you need for most situations.